Good morning, Jonathan Coe. How are you?
Good morning. I'm fine. I'm very good. Coping with this strange situation we find ourselves in.
Yes.
Trying to accustom myself.
Yes.
But yeah.
Okay.
I'm okay.
Where are you at the moment? In London or in the country?
I'm in London. I've barely left London except for a day or two for the last 6 months. Normally I do a lot of traveling, including coming to France, but of course it's not possible at the moment. I think it's the first time in 25 years that I had a book published in France and I didn't come to France to publicize it.
Yes, so, that's too bad. That's really too
yeah,
bad.
Yeah, it's the
we're going to try and make up for that.
Yeah, I hope so.
So let me introduce you first to our viewers, our spectators. You have published 13 novels, among which the most celebrated, What a Carve Up, which was published in 1994. Also, a trilogy started in 2001 with The Rotters Club, the last volume of which is Middle England, which came out in 2018. Now, your favorite setting is England. And you have an interest in politics and social issues. You're usually defined as a satirist in the line of British satirists such as Jane Austen or Evelyn Waugh or David Lodge more recently. But your most recent novel, Mr. Wilder and Me, is not set in England and has Austrian-American movie director Billy Wilder as one of its protagonists. So it may be seen as departing from familiar territories, all the more so since it is set in Greece, in LA, in Paris, in Munich, and also in London. The novel actually focuses on a Greek girl's discovery of the life and works of Billy Wilder, which entails a portrayal of Wilder himself. So my first question to you is, what and when was your own first introduction to the films made by Billy Wilder?
Okay, so my first introduction to Billy Wilder was not the typical one. When people think about this director, they think of films like Some Like It Hot, Sunset Boulevard, Double Indemnity, The Apartment, maybe. The films really of the first half of his career. My first introduction to Billy Wilder was through his late films, which many people don't like and which many people consider to be failures, but they're my favorite Wilder films. And it all began in 1975 when I was 14 years old. And my obsession at the time was Sherlock Holmes. The Sherlock Holmes stories, which I read over and over again, often with my grandfather, and I used to discuss them with him. And then one night on BBC television, I saw that they were advertising a film called The Private Life of Sherlock Holmes. And I watched it for that reason, because I was a Holmes fan. And when the credit came up on the screen, written and directed by Billy Wilder, it didn't mean anything to me, because I'd never heard of this guy, just like Callista in my novel. But I was bowled over by this film, which seemed to me not just to be a brilliant new Sherlock Holmes story, but added something to the Conan Doyle stories, which were not there before. Added humor, and added emotion, because this is a very tragicomic film, a film about a failed love affair that Holmes has kept secret and never spoken to anybody, and which has only just recently come to light through the discovery of a new manuscript. So seeing that film changed me, basically, from a Sherlock Holmes fan into a Billy Wilder fan. And just like Callista in my book, we're talking about the mid-1970s, so it was not easy to find, if you were living in the quiet suburbs of Birmingham, it was not easy to find out a lot of information about someone like Billy Wilder. You had to go to a big library, there were a few reference books, there were two or three books about him at this stage, no internet, no Googling, no watching the film again on DVD or streaming. And, you know, it took me a long time to find out more information about him, to realize that he was one of the most famous directors in Hollywood, to learn the names of films like Some Like It Hot and Sunset Boulevard, and to see these films, because the only way to see them was to wait for somebody to show them on TV.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's very different from the type of experience one may have now. I mean, the younger generation, everything's ready for use.
Everything's ready. You discover a new director and you can watch all his or her films in the next 2 or 3 days. You know, it's incredible.
Yes.
But also, you know, something, in a way, something has been lost by that instant availability, by which I mean the mystique, the mysteriousness, and the thrill of the quest, really, to find out more.
Yes.
And, you know, I wrote a long piece for Kaiju Cinema 20 years ago on this very subject, about my first viewing of The Private Life of Sherlock Holmes. And this was what I concluded, really, that it wasn't just the film itself that I fell in love with, but it was the mystery around it and the need to find out more.
Yes. How did you prep for this book? Because I guess you had to gather a lot of material about Billy Wilder.
Well, that piece I wrote for Coyote's Du Cinema all those years ago was called Diary of an Obsession. And I really have been obsessed with Wilder ever since I saw that film. So although this book is very information heavy, and there are a lot of acknowledgements at the back of the book listing the sources that I went to, actually, I did almost no prep for it at all, and almost no research for it at all, because I've been reading books and articles about him all my life, and even the quotations from Wilder that are scattered throughout the book, you know, I knew most of those off by heart already.
Oh, really?
So you know, it was. It's actually one of my least intensively researched books. Okay. The main bit of research I did was to watch all his films again in chronological order, but that was a very pleasurable bit of research.
I imagine. And how did you come up with the character of Callista? I mean, why did you cast a young Greek woman for the part?
Well, the fact that she was Greek was a given because Wilder shot quite a lot of Fedora, which is the film I write about in this novel, on location in Greece. And I had to find a reason to introduce this young woman into his working life, and making her a Greek speaker who could work as his interpreter was just the obvious solution. But there's, you know, there's another question to do with why I needed someone like Callista at all.
Yes.
And I was very excited about writing this book. I've been wanting to write this book, this novel, for many, many years, and now seemed like the right moment. And people started asking me, what book are you going to write next? And I said, oh, I'm writing a novel about Billy Wilder, with this gleam of excitement in my eyes. And they would look back at me and say, okay, yeah, he's a film director, right? If they were my daughter's generation, then they would say, who's that? Sorry. And I suddenly realized that this, you know, this giant of cinema who I'd been waiting to write about all my life was falling away from the collective memory. And I was going to have to find a way of telling this story, which made it appeal to people who didn't know anything about him, or perhaps weren't particularly interested in him, because my editor in London was very concerned about this book. She was very concerned that it was going to be a book for film enthusiasts. And she said, books about cinema don't sell.
Okay.
And I said, well, it's not really a book about cinema. It's a book about aging. It's a book about coping with changing fashions. It has many, many different themes. And she said, yeah, but a book with Billy Wilder's name in the title, people are going to think that it's a book about cinema. So I had to find a way into the story which was going to work for people who knew nothing about him or maybe weren't that interested in him to start with. So I made Callista very naive, very ignorant about cinema. She meets him in LA more or less by chance, has no idea who he is, and she learns as she goes along, which is just what I hope most, many of the readers of the book will do.
Hmm. And the novel is also about the relationship between America and Europe. And I was wondering if your female protagonist, an embodiment of that cradle of civilization that Greece may appear to be to a certain extent.
Yeah, of course. One of the reasons that I'm particularly interested and drawn to Billy Wilder's later films is that he made many of them in Europe. The Private Life of Sherlock Holmes was shot in London and Scotland. Avanti, the film after that, was shot in Italy and on the Amalfi Coast and in Rome. And for Fedora, he came to Greece, he came to Munich, he came to Paris. And I've always felt that you can feel in these later movies a sense of homecoming on his part, a sense of coming back to his European homeland after many years as an American film director. And, you know, if this novel had a single starting point, it was a line of his that I read in an interview when he was asked how it felt to come back to Germany to make a film, because most of Fedora was shot in at Bavaria Studios in Munich. And having lost most of his family in the Holocaust, he said, and being very disappointed that he couldn't get American finance for the film and feeling very bitter about that, because it was a bittersweet thing for him to come to Germany to raise the money for a film after that experience. He said, well, for me, this is a win-win situation. If the film is a hit, it's my revenge on Hollywood. If the film is a flop, it's my revenge for Auschwitz. And I was so struck by that comment and so struck by the, by the way it epitomizes the duality of his relationships, his relationship to America, his relationship to Europe, that, that really was what made me want to write about the making of this particular film. Mm-hmm. Because, to me, even when he's filming a very American subject, like, say, The Seven-Year Itch, he still feels like a European director. And it's very hard to define exactly what that means. But I hoped that by writing this book, I would give myself a stronger sense of that.
Yes, you did. Do you feel that a writer can learn from a movie director? I mean, from a technical perspective, I mean, obviously the two medias are very different, but did you learn from his films as a writer?
Yeah, very, very much, I think, but in an unusual way, because there are many critics, particularly some of the greatest French film critics. In fact, people like André Bazin and François Truffaut, who never liked Wilder, never liked his movies, and always said that filmmaking was a visual medium and he was not a visual director, that he told his stories too much in words, that he began life as a journalist, and you can feel this in his films because there's a lot of talk in his films, and the dialogue the story is moved forward by dialogue. I don't actually agree with this criticism. It doesn't bother me when I see his films. To me, the beauty of cinema is that it's a visual medium, but also a verbal medium, and you can You know, you can have beautiful dialogue in a movie just as you can in a novel or in the theatre. But it's true that compared to a director like Hitchcock, for instance, Wilder's screenplays are verbally very rich and very interesting, and he uses language in a very particular way. And I got to know this very well when I was a teenager, because I used to record his movies from the television. I don't mean onto videotape, because we didn't have videotape back then. I mean onto audio tape. So I would make cassette recordings of the complete soundtracks of his films whenever they were broadcast.
That's impressive.
And I would listen to them again and again, often in bed before I went to sleep. Actually, I think I have one here. Yeah, here we are. This is my cassette recording of The Private Life of Sherlock Holmes.
Oh, great.
Made in 1978. So I would listen to these movies at night and learn not just the rhythms of his dialogue and the wit of his dialogue, but I would also learn how he revealed character through dialogue and how he moved narratives forward through dialogue. And you know, that's been my way as a novelist ever since. I think other novelists write visual description. Other novelists are very good at interiority and getting inside the psychology of their characters. I tell my stories through dialogue more than anything else, and that, I think, comes directly from having listened to the soundtracks of his films all those times.
I see. You wrote a biography of B.S. Johnson, and I was wondering, why not a biography in this case, and what are to you the comparative assets of fiction in accounting for a creative life?
There's a very simple answer to that and a more complicated answer to that. The simple answer is that there are already several good biographies of Billy Wilder, and I didn't feel I had anything to add to them. The more complicated answer goes back to my biography of B.S. Johnson, which actually, now that I think about it, I presented at the Mollar Bookshop maybe 10 years ago, I guess.
Oh, you did?
I did, yeah. In person, not online.
Those were the days.
Those were the days. And, you know, that was a very difficult book to write. Took me a long time. It took me 7 or 8 years. It was a much longer and more complicated book than I expected it to be. And although I think I did the best I could with the form I was working within, writing it left me very dissatisfied with biography as a form. Biography, specifically biography as a way of getting inside the head of another creative person. And fundamentally, I guess, all the time I was writing it, I felt that everything I was writing about B.S. Johnson was dishonest in a way that it wouldn't, that I never felt when I was writing fiction about invented characters. What I like about the novel is the purity of the relationship between the writer and the reader, the purity of the contract you undertake, where you know that everything you're writing is invented. I felt that a lot of what I was writing in the B.S. Johnson biography was dishonest in a way that it wouldn't have been if I was writing a novel about him. And at the end of that process, my overwhelming feeling was that I wished in a way that I had written a novel about him instead. So when it came to writing about Wilder, who is an even more important figure to me than B.S. Johnson was, I didn't want to attempt another piece of nonfiction, because I felt I could get closer to him by novelizing him. You know, closer to the truth, really, a different kind of truth, but maybe a more fundamental, a more interior truth.
Yes. And which is your favorite Billy Wilder movie? Is it Fedora? Is it The Private Life of Sherlock Holmes or any other?
You know, when you... we come back to the word obsession again. When you watch someone's movies obsessively for years and years, you kind of lose objectivity about them, and also you kind of you no longer see the flaws and the virtues. You watch them kind of in a more critical way, and with more knowledge of their biography and the stories behind the films. Mm-hmm. So when I watch Fedora now, I don't really see the film as it is shown on the screen, because I know too much about what was happening just off camera or behind the scenes. And you know, just like Callista at the end of my novel, when she sees the scene with William Holden sitting at the table outside the hotel, she doesn't see his character, she sees the actor, and she knows that Wilder is just off screen behind the camera. And it's kind of the same when I watch Billy Wilder's films now, that I most of them I know so well that I can't really watch them innocently, if you like. Mm-hmm. So just recently, when as I said, I was watching all of his films from start to finish in order to prepare for this book, I saw, for instance, a war movie that he made in the 40s called Five Graves to Cairo. And I hadn't seen it for 40 years, and it was unfamiliar to me. And I loved it for that reason, because, you know, I was seeing it with fresh eyes. And that night I thought, wow, this is my favorite Billy Wilder movie. But all I meant really was that I didn't know it as well as I know the others. Mm-hmm. So the short answer is that I love them all, but I can't really enjoy them anymore because I know them too well.
Okay. You said earlier that the book was also, and I agree with that, was also about coping with fashions. Now, being a successful writer, both commercially successful and critically acclaimed, you can't be identifying with Wilder as an artist lacking the support of the industry towards the end of his life. Now, what is it that draws you to this particular figure? Is this book a way of bracing up on your part for a similar situation, as in anticipation of the fall, or to ward off bad luck? Do you ever think of the possibility of that you could find yourself disconnected from the times, from a potential audience?
Yeah, that's always been a fear of mine. And, you know, although I'm 10 years younger than Wilder was when he made Fedora, still, I've been in this business a long time now. I've been publishing books for 35 years. And, you know, British newspapers have started to use these terrible phrases about me, like elder statesman. And you start to realize that that you're becoming part of the older generation. And you know, I'm very happy with that at the moment, and I'm quite comfortable with my relationship with my readers, and I have plenty of ideas for novels to write in the next few years.
Good.
But
I'm glad to hear that.
But you know, that's not going to go on forever, and the story of Wilder being turned down when he asked for the money to make Fedora, and being humiliated really by the young producers at the Hollywood studios. Ever since I heard about it, that's always struck a kind of chill into my heart, and I've always wondered what that would feel like, and how he dealt with it, what it felt like for him. And that was, you know, although it's one of the unhappiest episodes in his professional life, really, it was always the episode that I wanted to write about if I was ever going to write about Wilder. Mm-hmm. And I hope I haven't made it into a bitter or unhappy book, because you know, the the triumph of Fedora, as far as I'm concerned, is that even though it's not a perfect film by any means, the triumph is that he got it made. And he made it more or less the way he wanted to. So the word I always use about it is I think that it's a heroic film because it was made against the odds. But, you know, there will come a time, even for a novelist, when you find yourself in a similar situation. And it hasn't happened to me yet, but as you say, using this very nice phrase, in some ways, writing this book is a way of bracing up for when that moment comes.
Okay. As a reader, I have found myself particularly drawn for the past months to the type of satirical comedy that you're writing. In fact, I've read a number of your novels that I hadn't read before. And I believe it might be sort of an antidote to the threat of slipping into depression. I feel that satirical comedy and novels of social manners are some sort of antidepressant at the moment. Now, what is your experience? And to your knowledge, has there been a spectacular surge in the sales of your own fiction or in the fiction of contemporary or classical British satirists?
I hear a different thing from readers, which is that not that they want satire about the present moment, but they want something more drastic than that in a way, which is escape from the present moment.
Yes.
You know, people, some of the people who have liked Mr. Wilder and me have told me that this is the reason that they like it, that it takes them out of the COVID pandemic, it takes them out of Brexit, and it takes them back to America and Greece and France in the 1970s, and indeed my British publishers marketed it as a piece of escapism, really, as, you know, a book that would transport you to a Greek island in the sunshine, the very thing that that British readers can't experience for themselves at the moment. I'm hearing from readers a lot, and this relates to your question, that they're anxious that if they read books which talk directly about the present moment, then yes, they will be depressing. I'm wrestling with this problem myself in a very practical way at the moment, because I'm writing a book now, which is a novel now, which is set in Britain, partly in the past, partly in 2020, and it's very, very realistic. It's you know, my most straightforward work of realism for a long, long time. And yes, trying to give it that energy, trying to give it that spark, and not let it be weighed down by the feeling of, you know, captivity and stasis and inertia that we've all been subject to in the last 12 months is difficult. It's quite a challenge.
Yeah.
And at the back of my mind, I have the idea for my next book, which is much more the kind of thing you're talking about, where I think it would be nice just to kind of let rip satirically, leave realism behind, and just turn what's happened in the last couple of years into fun and anger and satire and mirth. So those are the two paths that are available to me, and I'm taking both of them at the moment, one after the other. So I'm very conscious of the two paths, one leading to satire, one leading to realism, which constitute a choice. And, you know, that's a very significant choice for me. So, first of all, let's see if I can write realistically and soberly about the present moment and make that into a book which people actually want to read, because, you know, I'm not sure that really there's much of an appetite for it on the part of readers right now. As you say, people want to escape into something different.
Yeah. So I gather that the current pandemic is a motive of your next fiction, right? In that realistic book you're writing?
Well, it's not in any sense a theme of the book. But a large part of the action is set in 2020, so you know obviously you can't you can't ignore it. Mm-hmm. And also, you know, we're in a moment in Britain right now where you can't untangle what we've been going through in 2020 from what we've been going through since 2016 or even earlier, because we find ourselves in a very strange situation politically, because we have a government which was elected for one reason, and for one reason only, by the British people, which was to implement Brexit. Mm-hmm. And the moment they got elected, COVID arrived. And you know, it's by no means clear that Boris Johnson is the prime minister you would choose to leave the country through a grave national public health crisis. But that's who the people voted for another reason entirely. Mm. We've 2020 was very difficult for us because the government really struggled to get on top of the pandemic because it didn't suit their skill set at all. It was really a case of the wrong people being in the wrong place at the wrong time. Mm-hmm. Now I think the Britain has got its act together a little bit more, and we're vaccinating very quickly. And
right.
You know, in many ways we're dealing better with the pandemic at this particular moment than some other European countries are. But
it's true.
But this disease and its progress is very unpredictable and keeps throwing curveballs. So, you know, we don't know what's going to happen next.
Speaking of Brexit, do you feel that the cycle that you started with the Rotters Club is over? Will there be a sequel to Middle England?
I'm pretty sure there will be a sequel to Middle England. Good. I don't want to announce it with 100% certainty, because you never know what's going to happen. But people have started talking about these three books, The Rotters Club, The Close Circle, and Middle England, as a trilogy. And it's interesting how ready people are to do that, because there's something about the idea of three books which really seems to appeal to people and provide some sort of sense of completion and satisfaction. But I don't really think of them as a trilogy. I at first I thought there were going to be two volumes, and then I decided to add Middle England, the third, and having done that, to complete the story, it feels to me necessary now to add a fourth. Mm. But I don't think I'll be doing it for a number of years. Mm. That will have to wait.
There's something about the composition of that series which reminds me of what Updike did with the Rabbit series. I guess you're familiar with it. Rabbit Run, Rabbit Redux.
Yes. Yep. And did he know how many of those books he was going to write, or did he as the moment dictated?
No. Yeah. To my knowledge, it was quite spontaneous, or it was not planned.
Yeah. I mean, in a strange kind of way, I think that Middle England has improved the first two books in my mind. Because the first two books were conceived as a pair, and the relationship between them was very close, too close, I think. I tried to make them interlock and fit together in a way which made them almost lifeless. And by revisiting the characters 15 years later and taking them in a completely different direction, a direction which I couldn't have predicted at the time, it's kind of reanimated the other two books for me a little bit, and made me interested in going back to those characters again in a way which, you know, which I hadn't been before.
Mm. I personally enjoyed Middle England a lot. Now, people in France have read a lot for the past year, and it seems that new readers may even have emerged from what I read. Does Britain experience a similar situation to your knowledge?
Similar, but probably not on the same scale. If you want to illustrate the difference between Britain and France in one fact, it's that in France the bookshops never closed, and the bookshops were considered an essential service.
They did close for the first lockdown.
The first lockdown.
Yeah.
Yeah. In Britain, the bookshops have been closed for about 6 out of the last 12 months, I think.
Okay.
And in fact, the bookshops, having been closed in the first lockdown, they reopened, and then they closed again on November the 5th, the day that Billy Wilder and Me was published in the UK. So, you know, I published a novel here, and there wasn't a single bookshop open in the country where people could buy it. Of course, people go online, but it still doesn't help sales. And now bookshops were closed again all through January, February, and March, and they've just reopened a couple of weeks ago. Mm. It's true that people can buy online, people can click and collect and get physical books that way. And I do, when I talk to friends of mine who are musicians and actors, I feel a little bit guilty about this because, by comparison, writers have had a good pandemic.
Mm.
You know, it hasn't affected my working life particularly. Mm. My writing life takes place at home anyway, so I've been able to continue that uninterrupted. Events like this, I now have to do online, but at least they can still be done. The public has been stuck at home, so they're either watching movies and series on Netflix, or when they get bored with that, then they want to read a book. So there has been a modest boom in book sales here. Not a huge boom, but a noticeable one.
Okay.
And it's not been such a bad time for writers in that respect.
Yeah. Now, your protagonist, Calista, is an interpreter, and as a literate translator myself, I'm curious to know about your relationship to translation and to translators. Now, how do you feel about your work being translated, and how did you interact with your translators? I mean, your French translators or others? Have you ever collaborated in any way with some of them?
The best translators, in my experience, tend to be quite independent-minded. They're not on the phone to you the whole time. They're not emailing you the whole time with queries. So José Camoun, who translated my previous 3 or 4 novels, and Marguerite Capel, who has translated this one, have done their own thing. And usually produced, you know, complete drafts of the translation. And then they will send me emails with a few pages of queries, very specific, very, very small, very detailed queries a lot of the time. And I answer those, and that's that. But these are very talented people who I trust implicitly. I'm monolingual, more or less. I can speak a little bit of French, but my French isn't good enough to judge the quality of a translation. I actually quite enjoy reading passages in my novels in French because I'm not embarrassed by my own use of language anymore. I can understand the meaning, but I'm not constantly looking at it thinking, oh, I wish I hadn't chosen that word, or that sentence has a really clumsy rhythm. It's it's somebody else making the choices, and in a strange way, I can relax more into the story and the characters. I was reading a few pages of Marguerite's translation of Billy Wilder and Me the other day, and I started laughing. I thought, wow, this is really funny. And then I looked at the passage again in English, and didn't strike me as particularly funny, because I thought, well, I could have done that better. My timing there wasn't great. But unfortunately, there are no other languages where I'm in a position to be able to do that. I can get a sense of the rhythm of a translation in my Italian versions and the Spanish. But you know, when I'm sent a translation in Hebrew or a translation in Dutch or even a translation in German, I have no idea what I'm looking at. You just have to trust the translator to have done a good job.
Yeah. The British book industry is not much interested in translations, but do you yourself read French fiction or French literature in translation?
Yeah, probably as much as I do British fiction, actually, which is not a lot, because I don't read a huge amount of contemporary fiction myself. But it was a French novel which had a big influence on the writing of Billy Wilder and Me, because somebody told me, oh, there's a really interesting novel in French about Ravel, and I didn't know much about his life, and the idea that someone had written a novel about him intrigued me a lot. So I bought a copy of Jean Echeneau's novel Ravel, mm-hmm. and read it, and was really bowled over by this novel, and felt that it was very audacious. Very experimental in some ways, and yet it had taken me into the interior life of this man in a way that no biography could possibly have done. And I don't think I've matched his achievement at all with what I've done with Billy Wilder, but that novel was one of my main inspirations for this book, and the book that gave me the courage, really, to think that maybe this could be done, or at least attempted. I've really enjoyed Maëlys de Kerangal's novels over the last few years. Mm. She's translated in the UK and quite well known.
Good.
The situation isn't quite as dire as it was maybe 10 or 15 years ago. There are a lot of small independent publishers now who are publishing fiction in translation in this country. And there is a small but dedicated readership for these books, but it's apart from Elena Ferrante, which is a rare phenomenon of translated fiction becoming a very big bestseller. The market for it is still quite small, but I'd say more books from France and from other languages are being translated in the UK now.
Okay, good. Well, I was very glad to be able to talk to you, even though it would have been much better if if you'd been here in Bordeaux with us.
And I think I'm invited to a festival in Bordeaux in November, so maybe I'll...
Lettres du Monde must be.
Yes.
Oh, yep. Good.
So maybe it will finally be possible for me to come back.
Yes, and we'll plan something at the university then. I'll be glad to welcome you at the university. Yeah, I usually work with those people at Lettres du Monde.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, great. Yeah. Good news. Well, okay. I wish you a very pleasant summer. I mean, the most pleasant summer one may have in the present circumstances with the uncertainties.
Yeah.
But, And I hope the book Billy, Mr. Wilder and Me, we didn't comment on the title, but I like the ambiguity about the and me, which is an interesting way of putting it in perspective your own relationship to Wilder.
Yeah, yeah. It's good. Great. Well, thank you. It's been really nice talking, and thank you for your questions.
You're welcome.
And maybe see you in November.
Yeah.
Who knows?
Yeah, it would be my pleasure. Thank you, Gianfranco.
Okay.
Bye-bye. Have a good day.
Bye-bye.